Your Majesty, Queen Maxima, Your Royal Highness, Princess Mary of Denmark, dignitaries, ladies, and gentlemen, a very warm welcome to all of you on the second day of the third World Conference of Women Shelters.
There is no justification for domestic violence, ever. That is very clear. It is a universal problem, and it is happening in all countries and all cultures. It affects all social groups and all ages, and is often hidden from the outside world. If you are financially dependent on your partner, it is far harder to break out of the circle of violence in order to make a fresh start. That is why we need to keep promoting women economic empowerment in combination with education and raising awareness.
My name is Iffat Gill. Today I stand in front of you deeply conflicted because part of me feels that by sharing my story today with you, I'm at some level betraying my family. But at the same time, a strong part of me knows that if we don't talk about these stories, there is no hope for any sort of change.
I think we need to acknowledge that shelters and the work that we do in the area of violence against women is imperative. Mm-hmm. We are the ones who live with women, we're saving lives. Women and all over the world should be able to pick up a phone and get help.
Whole housing sector response in the UK to tackling domestic abuse alongside those specialist services to make this everybody's business.
Gerlinde Silvis is Director of Human Resources for the Rabobank, and she will also address women self-sufficiency in her speech, in her contribution to this conference.
The women of IMD all have a dream: education for their children, so that they can build themselves a better future. And that's a dream they share with all women all over the world, because education is an important step towards development and growth.
And the Australian government is firmly of the belief that unless we are tackling gender inequality as the root cause of violence against women and their children, we will not make long-term change.
Probably surprising that a company, global company like Ernst & Young EY is here at this conference, and we're sponsoring with heart and pleasure. And this is because women are in our social responsibility program already for more than 15 years. Mm-hmm. And let's see what we can do together, because we are working for one cause. We're working for a better society, for economic inclusion, yes, for social inclusion, and hence for prosperity.
NGO promote the specific law on domestic violence. After 15 years advocacy, now there is a process. Our lawmakers is going to adopt the specific law on domestic violence.
Of course, we need to work with the protection and the support to the survivors of violence until the violence ends. And at the same time, we need to work with the cause of the violence, and with the men, both in primary prevention, with men and boys and girls and women.
I think that we share something: courage first, work collaboratively, engage in men, and never forget the survivors. Empower the survivors, advocate with them, and never for them on our own.
As a survivor myself, I don't call myself a victim, I'm a survivor, and I believe women who are affected by domestic violence, no one is a victim. They are all survivors.
Good morning, good morning. What a day we had yesterday, didn't we? How are you this morning? It's great to see you all back here. So we have an action-packed day ahead for you, mostly taken up by the parallel sessions that you will be attended. But we have a very heavyweight plenary session, actually two, lined up as well. For example, this afternoon, the Crown Princess Mary of Denmark will be here to address us all on the subject of global and regional networks. That's this afternoon. But we start the day with the theme of transboundary violence against women and with a man that I personally admire very, very much. Dr. Denis Mukwege is the world's leading expert on repairing physical and mental damage to women and children caused by gang rape as a weapon of war. Dr. Mukwege is a gynaecologist in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and although he spends most of his time advocating women's rights worldwide and running the hospital that he founded in Bukavu in Congo in 1998, he still finds time to operate on women and children and has become known as the man who mends women. The European Parliament awarded Dr. Mukwege the Sakharov Prize for freedom of thought. That was in 2014. It's a prize in honor of exceptional individuals defending human rights and fundamental freedoms. Dr. Mukwege will address you shortly, but first, I would like to ask you to put on your headsets because he will speak in French, and he will do so after a film that actually needs translation as well. A film to introduce him, and he will be with you shortly. Please enjoy the works of Dr. Mukwege.
In Congo woedt vanaf 1994 een burgeroorlog die aan miljoenen mensen het leven heeft gekost door honger en ziekte. Miljoenen anderen zijn gevlucht voor het geweld. Hoewel de oorlog officieel is beëindigd, wordt er nog steeds gevochten door verschillende milities. Een oorlog die in wezen gaat over de controle over de natuurlijke rijkdommen van Congo. Een bloedige en barbaarse strijd.
Donc c'est une guerre en fait qui se fait sur le corps des femmes. Et aujourd'hui, ce qui est plus grave, c'est qu'on a même des enfants nés issus du viol qui sont elles-mêmes violées. Et donc c'est un cercle vicieux qui n'a pas de fin. Je ne sais pas ce qu'il faut dire de plus pour amener les gens à être plus sensibles. Nous avons l'obligation de se mettre debout lorsque notre semblable souffre.
Dr. Denis Mukwege is gynaecoloog, mensenrechtenactivist en specialist in het behandelen van slachtoffers van seksueel geweld. In 1999 richtte hij het Panzi ziekenhuis op in Bukavu, in het oosten van zijn vaderland, de Democratische Republiek Congo. Hoewel zijn eerste doelstelling was om geneeskundige zorg gratis ter beschikking te stellen aan de bevolking van Bukavu, werd het ziekenhuis al gauw een centrum voor slachtoffers van seksueel geweld. Sinds de oprichting zijn er in het ziekenhuis meer dan 30.000 vrouwen met zwaar letsel aan hun geslachtsorganen behandeld. De oorlog in Congo is officieel voorbij, maar het gewapende conflict woedt nog steeds in het oostelijk deel van het land. De aanvallen op burgers, met inbegrip van massale verkrachtingen als oorlogswapen, vinden nog steeds plaats.
Ik
counted 10 of them. When they reached 10, I heard my children screaming in the bedroom. They were calling, "Mommy, they are putting sticks into us. They are putting sticks into us." I was wondering and thinking, these people have killed my husband. Now they are raping me on my husband's blood. Now they are raping my own children too. I lost my consciousness. I don't know how my husband was buried. I don't know how his flesh and body parts were picked up. I was in a hospital in Rankuba when I woke up.
Het baanbrekende, onvermoeibare en toegewijde werk van Dr. Mukwege voorziet in de niet aflatende enorme behoefte aan acute zorg. Dr. Mukwege zet zich al jaren in voor de slachtoffers van het gruwelijk seksueel geweld en is uiterst kritisch naar de regering en de gewapende groepen in de regio. Ook spreekt hij zich uit voor vrouwenrechten wereldwijd. Voor zijn moed, toewijding en vastberadenheid heeft hij meerdere internationale onderscheidingen ontvangen. In november 2014 ontving hij de Sacharovprijs voor de vrijheid van denken. Een onderscheiding die jaarlijks wordt uitgereikt door het Europees Parlement.
La région où je vis est l'une des plus riches de la planète. Pourtant, l'écrasante majorité de ses habitants vivent dans une extrême pauvreté liée à l'insécurité et à la mauvaise gouvernance. Le corps des femmes est devenu un véritable champ de bataille et le viol est utilisé comme une arme de guerre. La semaine dernière, plus de 50 personnes ont été massacrées à la machette dans le territoire de Beni, au nord Kivu. Les femmes enceintes sont éventrées et les bébés mutilés. Dans l'espace d'un mois et demi, 200 personnes ont été sauvagement tuées. Chaque femme est violée. Je l'identifie à ma femme. Chaque mère violée. Chaque mère violée, je l'identifie à ma mère, et chaque enfant violé, je l'identifie à mes enfants.
Maar zijn strijd is niet zonder gevaar. In oktober 2012 overvielen 5 gewapende mannen zijn woning, waarbij zijn lijfwacht werd gedood. Dr. Mukwege kon met zijn gezin ternauwernood aan deze aanslag ontsnappen en moest het land ontvluchten. Na een jaar in België wilde hij weer terug om zijn werk voor te zetten. Bij aankomst kreeg hij een waar heldenonthaal.
How can you still work? You're in the hospital. How can you keep safe?
Yes, today my life changed completely because now I'm working in the hospital and I'm living in the hospital for my safety. And I think that it's a question of ethic. How could I just give up when in the hospital there was thousands of women who were waiting for me.
Het bijzondere werk van Dr. Mukwege is tot op de dag van vandaag helaas nog steeds zeer actueel en relevant. Nog altijd wordt hij dagelijks geconfronteerd met de gruwelen van de gewapende strijd binnen de Democratische Republiek Congo. Daarom blijft hij zich inzetten voor de slachtoffers van seksueel geweld en blijft hij aandacht vragen voor de problemen in zijn land in het algemeen en de positie van vrouwen in het bijzonder. Dr. Mukwege, een voorvechter voor vrouwenrechten in Congo. Een baken van hoop. Een activist voor vrede en ontwikkeling.
Nous avons pris de temps et d'énergie à réparer les conséquences de la violence. Il est temps de s'occuper des causes. Des milliers de témoignages des victimes montrent que le peuple congolais a soif de justice, de paix et aspire au changement.
Nous sommes ravis et enchantés de l'accueillir parmi nous, Dr. Denis Mukwege.
Thank you. speaking. Chers membres du comité de la Fondation Women's Shelter, distingués invités, mesdames, mesdemoiselles et messieurs, chacun à vos titres et qualités. C'est avec un sentiment de gratitude que je me présente devant vous, car cette conférence témoigne d'une mobilisation globale d'acteurs déterminés à agir pour mettre fin aux violences faites aux femmes. Il y a urgence à agir et la mobilisation autour de ces forums présente une source d'espoir pour un avenir meilleur pour notre humanité. Aujourd'hui, il est question de solidarité. Nous devons reconnaître que dans chaque coin du monde, les femmes et les filles ont besoin d'un toit, un lieu où s'abriter de la violence, de la pauvreté et de la corruption. En 2015, la recrudescence des violences faites aux femmes, quel que soit leur type, constitue un recul révoltant de notre civilisation et une régression de l'un des plus grands progrès du XXe siècle, où les femmes se sont soulevées de par le monde pour recouvrer leurs droits, souvent avec succès, modifiant le paradigme de la soumission et de la domination masculine pour tendre vers l'égalité des sexes. Vous êtes ces femmes et ces hommes qui croient que les pratiques misogynes et machistes typiques des sociétés patriarcales doivent cesser immédiatement et sans aucune forme de négociation. Vous êtes ces hommes et ces femmes engagés dans un projet innovant, œuvrant pour la sécurité des femmes avec la campagne Agir avec le cœur. Et j'ai le plaisir de m'y joindre. Mesdames et messieurs, les violences que nous observons en temps de guerre sont les résultats de l'exacerbation des discriminations et des violences existant dans la société en période de paix au sein des communautés. Et lorsque l'état de droit est en faillite et que la guerre éclate, quand il n'y a plus ni foi ni loi, les démons machistes s'expriment dans toutes ses formes, comme on l'observe aujourd'hui avec effroi dans tous les conflits. Au mépris des principes élémentaires du droit international humanitaire, les femmes et les enfants sont devenus de plus en plus les cibles des combattants pour désorganiser les communautés adverses et les assujettir. En Bosnie, au Rwanda, au Soudan, le viol a été utilisé comme une technique de nettoyage ethnique. Au Nigeria, en Irak et en Syrie, la vente des femmes sur le marché d'esclaves fait de la honte à la communauté internationale et nous interpelle tous. Mesdames et messieurs, quel recul au XXIe siècle vers la triste mémoire de l'esclavagisme et de la traite des êtres humains. Le viol et les violences sexuelles sont utilisées comme une arme de guerre, et plus qu'une arme de guerre, une stratégie de guerre. En République démocratique du Congo, mon pays, les viols utilisés comme une stratégie de guerre se caractérisent par le fait qu'il est massif, méthodique et systématique. Mesdames et messieurs, les actes de ces viols comme armes de guerre produisent les mêmes effets que les armes classiques, à savoir les déplacements massifs des populations qui cherchent l'anonymat et la sécurité. Deuxièmement, la réduction démographique de la population par la transmission des infections sexuellement transmissibles et du VIH-Sida et la destruction de l'appareil génital des femmes et des enfants par différents objets introduits au niveau de l'appareil génital, rendant leur maternité hypothétique. Ces actes barbares portent atteinte à l'intégrité physique des victimes, s'accompagnent de la destruction de la capacité économique des populations ciblées par la destruction des récoltes et le pillage des ressources naturelles. Dans ce contexte, l'existence même du tissu social est menacée par ces actes d'humiliation, faisant perdre l'identité individuelle et après l'identité communautaire, avec une perte de cohésion sociale. Et les impacts de ces violences, malheureusement, se transmettent de génération en génération avec conséquences, avec retardement. Les enfants nés du viol, sans lien de filiation dans la communauté, viennent compléter ces tableaux de destruction du tissu social. Mesdames et messieurs, ces femmes et ces enfants sont accueillis à l'hôpital des Panzi, où nous assurons une prise en charge holistique sur base des quatre piliers. Le pilier médical, le pilier psychologique, le pilier socio-économique et le pilier juridique. Les soins physiques consistent en premier lieu par des efforts de prévention. Si la victime est prise en charge en dehors de 72 heures, nous avons un kit de prophylaxie post-exposition qui peut être administré immédiatement. Après 72 heures, nous assurons le traitement des infections sexuellement transmissibles ainsi que la prise en charge des patientes atteintes du VIH-Sida et nous apportons la meilleure réponse chirurgicale possible pour réparer les organes génitaux et les fistules génitales. Au même moment, la prise en charge psychologique est dispensée et constitue une phase importante des soins prodigués aux victimes. Lorsque les patientes se portent mieux sur le plan physique et psychologique, nous les transférons à la Cité de la Joie et à la maison d'accueil et de transit d'Orcas qui poursuivent la réhabilitation des survivantes avec l'encadrement psychologique et le renforcement des capacités visant l'autonomisation des femmes sur le plan social, économique et politique. À la Cité de la Joie, des jeunes femmes âgées de 15 à 25 ans sont accueillies pour une période de 6 mois. Dans une atmosphère chaleureuse et communautaire, les participantes suivent différents programmes et activités visant la détraumatisation, tels que la prise de parole en public, l'apprentissage du fonctionnement de leur corps, des outils de communication modernes, tels que l'informatique, l'anglais, le français, ou d'autres activités visées à permettre aux femmes victimes de regagner la confiance en elles, telles que l'ergothérapie, la danse, la musique et le self-défense. Alors qu'à la maison d'Orcas, les femmes et leurs dépendants sont hébergés pour une durée indéterminée, en moyenne 3 mois, en fonction de leur traumatisme et leur situation personnelle et familiale. Nous leur offrons des cours d'alphabétisation, des formations d'apprentissage des métiers divers, comme la vannerie, la savonnerie, la coupe-couture, etc. Nous couvrons les frais scolaires des enfants qui sont nés issus des viols ou des enfants victimes indirectement. Nos bénéficiaires sont également insérés dans des programmes de microcrédit pour exercer des différentes formes de commerce. Enfin, notre programme « Un toit pour les survivantes » offre aux femmes l'occasion de se construire leur propre toit. Aujourd'hui, j'ai le plaisir de partager avec vous le témoignage d'une de mes anciennes patientes, Espérance. Et je cite, « Aujourd'hui, je ne suis plus la risée de voisins. Je m'habille et nourris mes enfants du petit commerce reçu de Dorcas rurales. Mes enfants étudient, je n'ai plus de choc psychologique et j'habite une maison décente. J'ai récupéré ma dignité. » Pour compléter notre prise en charge et restaurer complètement la dignité des patientes, la clinique juridique des Panzi offre aux femmes qui les désirent et qui les demandent l'assistance légale qui comprend la constitution du dossier, les frais de représentation et d'accompagnement tout au long de la procédure par les avocats de la clinique juridique. L'objectif principal étant de transformer la souffrance en force, de transformer cette souffrance en pouvoir et d'outiller les bénéficiaires pour développer leur capacité à devenir autonomes à leur sortie. Cette prise en charge holistique aide les femmes à reprendre confiance et l'estime d'elles-mêmes. De plus, nous constatons avec satisfaction que beaucoup de femmes, après quelques semaines ou mois de traitement, d'accompagnement et de renforcement des capacités, deviennent de véritables activistes des droits humains, des droits de la femme, protégeant non seulement leurs droits, mais aussi ceux de leurs enfants et de leur communauté, faisant d'elles des leaders dans leur milieu. Mesdames et messieurs, nous ne pouvons pas nous limiter à réparer les conséquences de ces atrocités et de la bêtise humaine. Nous devons nous attaquer à leur cause. Le viol est une arme aussi dévastatrice que les autres armes de destruction massive et doit être éradiquée. Pourquoi n'y a-t-il pas des lignes rouges tracées contre l'utilisation du viol comme arme de guerre, alors que la communauté internationale s'est mobilisée et l'a fait contre les armes nucléaires, chimiques ou biologiques? Avec notre volonté, tous ensemble, nous pouvons faire tracer cette ligne à ne pas franchir contre les viols avec violence en période de conflit. Tant que l'impunité sera tolérée et qu'il n'y aura pas de redevabilité, le cycle de violence ne s'arrêtera pas. Il faut combler les fossés existants entre les lois et les conventions et leur mise en œuvre, car la justice est l'un des outils les plus efficaces pour garantir la non-répétition des crimes à caractère sexuel. Nous devons enfin changer et faire évoluer les mentalités et les rapports de pouvoir, de domination et de soumission existants au sein des structures sociales axées sur l'inégalité des sexes et les rôles sociaux. Mesdames et messieurs, ensemble, décideurs politiques, acteurs de la société civile, hommes et femmes, nous pouvons briser les silences et l'indifférence, décider de notre survie et retrouver notre humanité, car la lutte contre les violences sexuelles n'est pas qu'un enjeu de femmes, c'est un combat pour la société tout entière que nous devons mener avec un esprit de respect mutuel et de solidarité dans l'intérêt de tous. Je vous remercie de votre attention.
Docteur Mukwege.
Merci, madame.
J'ai une ou deux questions pour vous, docteur. Comment expliquez-vous, d'un point de vue d'homme, la situation qui se passe dans la tête de quelqu'un quand il s'agit de l'abus sexuel comme arme de guerre? Je ne comprends pas. Comment ça se marche dans la tête?
Je crois que c'est là le plus grand problème que nous avons, c'est que souvent ce sont des enfants qui subissent le lavage de cerveau, et ces enfants subissent le lavage de cerveau par des adultes, Après, ils se comportent complètement
comme
des robots qui posent des actes inhumains, mais ils les font de façon automatique.
Sans savoir ce qu'ils font.
En fait, sans se rendre compte de la gravité des actes qu'ils posent.
D'accord. Est-ce que vous pensez que la communauté globale agit de la manière comme vous voulez quand il s'agit de l'impunité?
Là, nous avons un sérieux problème.
Oui.
Et je crois que le monde devrait s'élever. Le monde entier, il n'y a pas que les femmes. Les hommes et les femmes doivent s'élever puisqu'il s'agit de notre humanité qui est en danger. Et aujourd'hui, nous avons le regret de constater que l'impunité est presque partout en ce qui concerne ces crimes contre l'humanité, ces crimes qui se commettent pour juste détruire la femme. Et aujourd'hui, nous souhaiterions qu'il y ait une ligne rouge qui doit être tracée clairement pour montrer que nous, notre société, notre communauté n'accepte pas d'utiliser cette arme comme une arme de guerre.
Grâce à vous, j'espère que le monde comprendra un petit peu ce que vous dites. Donc, je vous invite pour le moment de prendre place là-bas, tandis que pendant que j'invite d'autres personnes. Merci. Dr. Mukwege, ladies and gentlemen. I would at this moment like to ask a panel to join us on stage so we can talk about these matters more into detail. First of all, Corinne Dettmeijer, please join me. She's the National Rapporteur on Human Trafficking and Sexual Violence Against Children. Yes, let's talk here for a moment before I ask you to join the Dr. Mukwege.
Thank you.
Thank you for being with us. How would you, now that you've heard from Dr. Mukwege, do you think there is a relation to the work that you do? You have your own sound. Yes.
Yes, I definitely do. Dr. Mukwege, and I must say I'm humbled by what he's doing and all his wonderful work. I would hate to say, but I must say it, that in a society as ours, we also see an affront to dignity of women, children, and persons. And if I talk about modern slavery, human trafficking, then that's exactly what it's about. Taking away their dignity, their humanity, and that, I think, is, those are the sustainable things that a person needs to thrive. And if you take that away, you do not only take it away from those victims, you also take it away from their families, their loved ones, their children, and
their
it may
community.
Go on, and their community. And therefore, I think that it's not, combating human trafficking is not just something that law enforcement is responsible for. It's our whole community. It undermines our community, it tears at our social fabric, and we all need to to pull together, as also Dr. Mukwege says, to save our own humanity by saving theirs.
So there's about 900 of us agreeing with you today, but how do we get this outside of this room? How do we actually change the narrative? Because I believe that's the problem. We're not talking the same language in different places in the world when it comes to this subject.
I think it starts with recognition of the problem. And maybe women are, because they are more often a victim, more sensitized to this. But I hate to say we also need men, and I think therefore Dr. Mukwege is so special.
Yes, he is.
Yes, because we need men to give on this message. And I think women should not only speak from a role of a victim, not even of that as a survivor, but as a human being, as a proud person who is part of a community and deserves to live in with dignity and in humanity.
I said yesterday during a panel, maybe it's time we stop asking and start demanding or just doing.
Absolutely.
Is that what you're
yes.
trying to do?
Oh,
so,
yes.
Well, you got us with us. I'd
Good,
like
thank
you, to,
you
to join Dr. Mukwege, and we'll continue the panel from there. I would now like to invite Margarita Guille, the executive coordinator of Interamerican Network of Women's Shelters in Mexico, and together with her, Yanar Mohammed, she's a representative of Women's Shelter in Iraq. Please join the gentleman and the lady behind the desk.
Hello. Hello. Nice to meet you.
Hello.
So Margarita, starting with you, is it true what we hear, that violence against women, that there are rising numbers in violence against women and trafficking in Latin America? Is this true what we hear?
Well, yeah, numbers are rising, but I will say that with this condition of globalization, and because we need to recognize that also the world have changed, so the ways that perpetrators address to people and to women are changed, of course. So now what we are facing is not only trafficking, but a combined forms to have a violence against women and gender-based violence. For example, violence that is increasing the lethality and the brutality against women and girls when they are perpetrated in conflict situations, but are not classified as war, because there are no wars, but there are armed conflicts in several regions in Latin America, and also organized crime international that are transboundary sharing victims and people, exploitation, and have them as slaves. And people are facing a lot of risk, particularly women that have shelters in those cities, communities, and countries, because as the doctor mentioned, there is a lack of rule of law, there is lots of impunity, corruption, yes. There are like weakened democracies. Mm-hmm. So we need to regard this problem in another perspective.
So what is the first step that the continent needs to end this cycle?
Well, the first thing, I think we need to do a serious research and to understand that the situation to talk about violence against women have changed, and we need to really speak with the victims and with the survivors. What do they need? And also to be clear that women and girls are very strong. They have lots of resilience. They are very creative to face the local violence they're facing at homes, at their own communities and countries, and also when they are trying to get away of this situation, they try to migrate, yes. And then they finally are got by people that are really organized in a cellular, particular way, organized crime, transboundary, so they start another cycle, very risk of violence. So we need to map the problem, we need to name it, we need to strengthen civil society. This is not a women's issue, this is a democracy and governmental issue. We need also to put this not into safety agenda, but into the security of nations agenda. We need to recognize that this kind of violence against women and girls is not a situation personal for these ladies, yes. But it is a yes. Threat of our peace, global peace, and into security.
Exactly. Thank you, thank you. So, Yanar, your special focus is on women escaping enslavement from ISIS. How do you go about that?
You just need to sit with a woman, very young woman, sometimes teenagers, who has been sold over from one man to the other 15 times, and ask her, what is your hope in life? She would tell you, my young brother is still there, and she would show you a picture. And you would see all the hope in her eyes to be the future for the coming generation. I cannot let Ahlam down. She needs to get her brother out. She needs to find her sister. Her mother is still in there. We just cannot go back. Iraq has been put in a spot where there's 5 million orphans of war in it.
5 million?
5 million orphans of war, half of whom are female teenagers who don't know what to do with themselves. The government that has been installed in Iraq does not give them identification papers. The government leaves them as material for trafficking, material for exploitation, and the government is also making our jobs at running shelters very hard. They do not give us the legal status for the shelters. When they go in the international community, they brag that some NGOs do run shelters for women, but they do not give us the legal status.
So you're actually operating operating
Yes. Like outlaws. We have been doing that for 12 years, and we, because the government of the Netherlands helped us, we have a radio where we tell the victims to come into our houses. We have 6 locations where we are helping women and some LGBT to be empowered in life. And these are places for social transformation. I disagree with the issue that this is an issue of democracy. I think the women have to go through social transformation, and they have to stand up for their rights. They have to be there, they have to create the movement. That's why we are focusing on the graduates of our shelters to be the leaders for the coming time Iraq and of countries in the world to say no to these wars, no to the division of society based on religion, based on ethnicity or anything. Militia culture.
You share. You share with Dr. Mukwege the very sorry fact that your life is in danger because of the work that you do. How do you keep going? It must be terrible to know you're under threat.
This is a price you have to pay, we have to pay. When you live in a secret location, when your movements are sort of under control, when you don't go around walking in the streets very freely, but you see all the daughters who have become powerful, who have become full human beings, who have become leaders in the society, it's a very small price to pay.
Well, that's wonderful to hear. Yes. Dr. Mukwege, forgive me one question in English. I know you can manage. I've seen you on television speaking English, so you can do that. I would like to ask you, do you have a call to action for us here, for the people outside? What is it you want us to start doing today?
Thank you. I think that we need really to understand that our world is changing.
Yes.
And if you can go and tolerate esclavagism and just take it like it's happened for others, it's a big mistake. We need to understand that something is happening in our world which is not normal. The way that women are treating in our society is just a kind of to make our society to disappear. There is no choice. If you don't act now to say that this is not acceptable, that we can see again women with price, $100, $200. It's something making me very sad that the world can't stand up and say we can't accept that a human being be sold on the market.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Unfortunately, that's all we have time for today, but there are plenty of sessions during which you can get into depth on these subjects. I would really like to thank all of you for being with us this morning. Dr. Mukwege, Corinne Dettmeijer, Margarita Guille, and Yanar Mohammed. Thank you so very much for your contribution.
Thank you so much.
Wonderful. For some reason, this was a very moving session for me. Maybe it was for you as well. How to make the switch to the next part of the morning program? Let's just take a breath. I guess I needed that more than you did. So, ladies and gentlemen, safety for women, economic independence, and technology. They go hand in hand. In order to make a living, women need to travel, but how can they do that in the safest of ways and without fear? Cindy Southward of the NNEDF, the National Network to End Domestic Violence, is here to explain the importance of introducing, well, maybe she can tell you herself, Cindy Southward.
I also need a breath. As one of the hosts of the Second World Conference in Washington, D.C. in 2012, I have to say I am just so blown away to be here with all of you. And the morning's panel was just beyond inspiring, so thank you. Staff at Uber, which is a technology company, knew about our work at the National Network to End Domestic Violence. They knew that we were working with Facebook and Google and Airbnb and others in helping increase women's safety across the globe. Uber's a tech platform that connects riders and drivers. Before joining Uber, Lindsay Elan, an advocate, she worked for women's reproductive rights for years at Planned Parenthood, and she knew my boss and friend, Kim Gandy, who for many years led the National Organization for Women before she joined us. Lindsay came to me and to us at NNEDV and said, can you help us make Uber safer for women as riders, as drivers, and also can we together explore the possibilities of donating rides to and from shelters, obviously safely, privately, with no victim names. Jointly, we just wrote a guide highlighting existing safety features, some that are visible and some that run behind the scenes. And we're currently working and talking about new safety features we can implement together. When I ride Uber, I always ask the drivers about their experience in driving for Uber, especially since women make the same wage as men when they drive with Uber. One woman told me that she was a single mother in graduate school working to get her master's in social work, and she'd quit her other job since she could make the same money driving 2 days a week and spend the rest of her week with her child and studying for her graduate courses. The stories that I hear when I ride an Uber are always enlightening. Uber's brought 9 staff here this week from around the world to learn from all of you and listen to all of you and to connect. They want to hear your questions, your thoughts, and yes, your concerns. Some of you will join listening sessions over lunch today, and everyone is welcome to come by the Uber booth upstairs to talk today and tomorrow. I applaud any company that faces this feisty group of smart and passionate women and says, tell me how to improve. So it is my pleasure to introduce you to Abi Atwadi, the general manager for Uber in Lagos, Nigeria, where she's working on the economic empowerment of women. Please welcome Abi.
Thank you, Cindy, for that very warm welcome. My name is Abi Atwadi, and I'm the general manager of Uber in Nigeria, based in Lagos. It's an honor for my colleagues and I to be here today and to listen to all the inspiring stories and important work that's being done. Thank you also to the World Conference of Women's Shelters for having us. We're here at the World Forum to learn from experts, advocates, and survivors, and to be part of the conversation about the role of transportation and technology, which plays a huge role in women's lives. Transportation is a vital issue for so many women, whether they're getting to a safe place of work, going to a job interview, or heading home late at night. Recent studies have found that access to transportation is the single most important factor in ensuring economic mobility. For these reasons, we're here to listen and learn from experts like you who work closely with survivors and their families. And we plan to take your feedback to our engineering, safety, and executive teams to inform the way we innovate and build upon our technology. I'd like to tell you a little bit about Uber and what we're doing to provide safe transportation and open up access to economic opportunity. For those of you who might not know what Uber is, it's an app that connects you with a car ride whenever you need one. You can simply tap a button on your smartphone at any time of the day or night, and a driver will pick you up within minutes and take you wherever you need to go. Today, riders and drivers use the platform in 63 countries and over 340 cities around the world. Many of the communities we serve, like my home country, Nigeria, lack access to reliable transportation infrastructure. As we've heard from several speakers this week, mobility is critical to survivors gaining independence. So much hinges on the ability to get around in a safe, reliable, and affordable way. I'd like to tell you about what we do to facilitate this type of transportation. Let's talk first about safety. Before, during, and after the ride. Before a driver can even access the Uber platform, he or she must pass an extensive screening, including a background check. When you request a ride, you'll see your driver's photo, the car model, license plate number, in the app, and you can also watch them in the built-in map as they make their way towards you. Because you can watch your car on the app as they come to pick you up, you can wait safely indoors until they arrive. You can even request a ride for someone else in a different location and communicate with the driver to ensure their safe pickup. Uber is an affordable transportation option and a cashless experience in most parts of the world. Payment is done automatically and securely in the Uber app with a credit card or a debit card on file. This means there's no need to ever reach for your wallet or your purse. After every ride, both riders and drivers are asked to rate their trip. The feedback is completely anonymous and is reviewed by our support and safety team. We have customer support centers all around the world that respond to all incoming inquiries in real time from riders and drivers. We also have a dedicated incident response team that immediately addresses any issues that may arise before, during, or after the ride. So how does all of this impact women in particular? In Saudi Arabia, where female students make up 60% of the university population, the vast majority of our riders are women. And in Nigeria, a significant number of women use the app as a safe way to get home after a long day at work. We also learned about one rider in Nigeria who uses Uber to pick up her son from school. We learned of another rider who's over the age of 80, and she relies on Uber to get to and from her medical checkups. In short, mobility is fundamental to an independent life. And women are not just using Uber for rides. They're actually also now getting behind the wheel. In March of this year, we announced our commitment to bring economic opportunity to 1 million women worldwide by 2020. In the United States, about 22% of our driver partners are women. And just to put that into context, 1% of taxi drivers in New York City are women. We have many exceptional women driving on the platform, like Esther, which I'd love to introduce you to in this video from Kenya.
A woman driver in Nairobi, it doesn't mean that you're no longer a woman in the house or something. To me, this is a job, and I take it as a job, and I do it with my everything. My name is Esther. I live in Nairobi, and I work with Uber as a driver. Nairobi is an interesting city. We have wild animals. It's a beautiful and colorful place. Driving in Nairobi, it's not that easy. I work in a taxi company. Up to last year, July, we were struggling. The work, long, long hours, to an extent that I couldn't even see my baby. She can't even remember there is a mommy somewhere. I just called daddy. Since I started working with Uber, my life has changed, because I've been able to divide time for my family and also for me to work.
Round of applause for Esther. For so many women like Esther, other full-time or part-time jobs are simply not a possibility, as they often require strict schedules and much longer hours. The flexibility of the Uber platform has enabled many women to balance a variety of obligations, from taking care of their families to finishing their education. So now that we've introduced Uber to you briefly, we want to learn how it can help you, your organization's mission, and the women you work with. For our technology to truly have an impact, we need to understand the needs of communities. More important than anything we can offer you today, we want to learn from your collective expertise and your experience. We've worked with Cindy and her team at the National Network to End Domestic Violence to put together a guide that explains all the safety features of the Uber app. And we've already spoken to a number of groups this week who have proposed great creative ideas and given constructive feedback. Many of you have an invitation to join our listening sessions over lunch today from 12:30 to 1:15. We have 9 listening sessions in total, divided up by focus regions in the Amazon foyer. And if you're not attending a listening session over lunch with us, we would still love to hear from you at our stand. Thank you for having us here today. We're incredibly honored to be here. We look forward to working with you to create safe transportation options and economic opportunity for the women in your communities. Thank you.
Thank you, AB. Let me just shortly recap the info. Thank you very much, AB. The info just given to you. Some of you, in the conference bag, you will have found information on how to connect to Uber. And some of you will have an invitation in your badge pocket. I don't know how else to call it, the little thingy that you wear around your neck. And some of you have an invitation to for the session between 12:30 and a quarter past one to be with Uber. This will take place in the Amazon foyer and the Amazon roundabout foyer on the first floor. No info on the back. And all Dutch invitees to Uber are expected in the Amazon room. So we have the foyer, the roundabout foyer, and the room. Please check the signs. And of course, all of you are welcome to get your information at the Uber stand in the reception area. So this rounds up the morning session, ladies and gentlemen. As we are running a bit late, but we are glad we did because the content matters more than the clock, but we are running a little bit late, so all the panel, no, the parallel sessions, too many P's. The parallel sessions will start at a quarter past 10, and the second round will also start 15 minutes later. But we do want you to all be back here on time at 1:30 for the afternoon plenary, because that's when the Crown Princess of Denmark will address us. So go out and play nice and do great things in the panel sessions. And I'll see you this afternoon. Thank you so much. I'd like to invite, this just came up at the last minute. Please forgive me. We have a delegate from Afghanistan that would really like to share 2 minutes with you. So please, sorry about this, but it will be worth your while. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you.
You have 2 minutes.
Okay. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Maria Kremi, the founder of First Woman Shelter in Afghanistan, which we have started our work since 2002 after Taliban fall. I'm here today to share with you the situation of Afghan women, that we have a lot of positive progresses during the last 14 years. But 2 days before, we heard about a woman which is going to stoning on the in front of all people, but unfortunately that now we see the world, the women around the world is going to forget Afghanistan and forget women of Afghanistan. 2001, when the Taliban had fought, all the international community was there, and we, by their support, have run so fast, and we have made so much positive progresses, which is right now in Afghanistan, more than 27 safe houses around the country. The other side is fighting, the other side is the women of Afghanistan is protecting and supporting women of Afghanistan and sacrificing their lives like us. But today I'm calling on you all, do not forget women of Afghanistan. Please be with us and show and give hands of unity and solidarity, because we never want to go back. Women of Afghanistan want to go forward, and that's, as my belief, women movement is a global movement. That was not happen with one or two. That was all of you. This is why that today we call on all of you to be with us and give hands that we should go forward and protect women of Afghanistan. And women could be a great change maker as a peace builder around the world and peace builders in Afghanistan. That's why I'm calling, and please be united with all of us.
Yes, thank you so very much for this. Thank you very much. We must not forget the women of Afghanistan. So please keep that in mind as you now, I promise I won't call you back, as you now go to your panel sessions. See you this afternoon.